Hello viewers, welcome. This is Hope Channel, your preferred Christian television station, broadcasting from here in Accra, Ringwe Estate, Osu. The program is From Egypt to Canaan, A Christian Journey. It airs on this channel on the advertised times, and we are glad to bring to you Bible-based studies for us to explore the parallels between the Israelites' journey from Egypt to Canaan and what this means for our Christian experience. Remember Paul writing to the people in Corinth in 1 Corinthians 10:11 says that now all these things happened unto them for examples, and they are written for admonition, upon whom the ends of the world are come. Therefore, our underlying point here is that whatever happened with the journey of the people of God from Egypt to Canaan has lessons for us in our Christian journey. You're welcome to today's episode. Today, I have here the resource persons who are here with me on a weekly basis. To my immediate left, we have Nana Ofori Brown. Nana worships with the Prince Emmanuel Seventh-day Adventist Church, and he's an author of the book, God's Holy Law, Matters That Truly Matter. And to the extreme left is Elder Ernest Kusi Abebio, who worships with the Legon Seventh-day Adventist Church. I am your host, Charles Othinelabi. Thank you for making time to be here. Invite your family, your friends, take your Bible and your notepads and pen, whisper a prayer. Because when we come back from the break, I introduce to you the topic for today's study, and then we delve into our discussion. The program is From Egypt to Canaan, A Christian Experience. We'll be right back. Thank you for staying with us and inviting your friends to join with us to study the Word of God. And this program is From Egypt to Canaan. Today we are having an interesting topic. Remember, last week we studied affliction yields deliverance. And today the topic for our study is a leader chosen. So I want to bring in my resource persons, and then together we go into the study. Nana, last week when we met here with God's Children studying, we reflected on affliction yielding deliverance. And maybe just to recap for our viewers, we have understood that the patriarch Jacob has come into Egypt with his children, and he had also literally given a prelude to what they would become.
Yes.
And we studied about how the 12 tribes of Israel, looking into Revelation, how each of them, their names were on, you know, the gates. But an important thing we want to recap from last week's study is the people who were in Egypt. The Bible tells us that there arose a Pharaoh who knew no Joseph.
Yes.
One would want to ask, is it the arrival of this new Pharaoh who didn't know Joseph and what Joseph and his people represented, for which reason he became a cruel and difficult king and subjected the Israelites to so much torture, or something else triggered this, you know, era of wickedness by this ruler? Mm.
Thank you very much, Charles. And I'd like to say hello to our viewers. Now, I think last week we touched on the fact that in our very last episode, we touched on the fact that it was out of the affliction that the Israelites were being subjected to, for which then they called on to their God to ask for deliverance. The Israelites were living a peculiar life. They lived very differently from the standards of this world. When we get into the New Testament, Paul says that we should not be conformed to the pattern of this world, but we should be transformed by the renewal of our mind. And so we made the allusion that even in our day today, if Christians do not live a life that conforms rather to the standard of God, but they live their lives or their ways just as the world is living, then there will be no need for them calling on God, because they have already fit into the system. They are not going to call on God, and God is not going to send in any sort of deliverance. So I think the lesson there is that as a Christian, as one who has purposed in their lives to follow Christ, how are you living your life? Is it so different that the people of the world observe you and say, this one does not fit in, and therefore they kind of put their eyes on you to want to oppress you? This is what brings in the power of God to draw us away or out of the afflictions that we go through.
Thank you very much. So, Elder, from what Nana has explained, and clearly for us today, living in this earth's last history, as we always say, if this is what happened with the Israelites, where they were peculiar people, then for us living in these times, we also should be very different and peculiar. And this should invite the wrath of the enemy, Satan and his people. Is this not the case?
Exactly, Charles. Thank you very much also for bringing me into this discussion. Listen, Paul says something, I think, in 1 Corinthians 15. He said that if in this world only, you know,
1 Corinthians 15.
I think it's 1 Corinthians 15,
Okay.
1 Corinthians 15, verse 12.
So if you have just joined us, the program is...
Verse 19. Yes.
1 Corinthians 15, verse 19. This program is from Egypt to Canaan, and we are studying today a leader chosen. So 1 Corinthians 15, 19, it says, If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable.
That's it. We are among all men most miserable because this life, what is in it for us?
Tell us.
As Christians, we should see ourselves as pilgrims. This earth is only a stage. We are passing through it. But if you have say, water, and you have salt, and you put salt in water, really, do you see the salt?
No, it dissolves.
Until you taste it.
Yes.
But once it stands as a solution, you don't see any difference. If that is how Christians are to live their lives in this world, then we are among all men most miserable. We need to be distinct. If you put potassium permanganate, because I'm a scientist, if you put potassium, it's pinkish.
Okay.
It discolors the water, and you know certainly something is in there. We need to be distinct. Now, when we read Exodus,
yes,
chapter 1,
Exodus,
you can read
one.
from 7 to 12.
Exodus chapter 1, verse 7 to 12.
Yes.
And the children of Israel were fruitful and increased abundantly and multiplied and waxed exceeding mighty, and the land was filled with them. Now there arose up a new king over Egypt, which knew not Joseph. And he said unto his people, behold, the people of the children of Israel are more and mightier than we. Come on, let us deal wisely with them, lest they multiply. And it come to pass that when there falleth out in any war, they join also unto our enemies, and fight against us, and to get them up out of the land. Therefore they did set over them taskmasters to afflict them with their burdens, and they built for Pharaoh treasure cities, Python and Ramses.
Right.
But the more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied and grew, and they were grieved because of the children of Israel. And the Egyptians made the children of Israel to serve with rigor.
You see, what conditioned Pharaoh to become that wicked towards the children of Israel? They were prospering. They were multiplying. Listen, if we are the children of God, God will bless us. Amen. The blessings go with his people.
Okay.
We'll be blessed. And things will look good for us.
Okay.
In the workplace, when people are, you know, maneuvering and orchestrating to cheat, you stand out. I said, no, we can't do this. It is against God's commands. Not necessarily against the organization's rules,
So it is not about the company policies?
No, at all. It is about your relationship with God. Just as Joseph would say, how can I do this against my God? When Potiphar wanted to seduce him. It is against God. A Christian, your life is centered on God. It is Christ who is the center of your life. Whatever you're doing, you need to be looking up to Jesus. And so, if we will live our life like this, your family are against your wife because she's not giving birth. Okay? Mm-hmm. You've married 2 years. There hasn't been any baby. Then your family gang up against your wife and say, why are you not giving birth? Mm. Now, as a Christian, what do?
Prayer.
Because you believe that children are an inheritance from the Lord. So you are not the source of it. Mm-hmm. You understand? So you need to defend your wife. But if you yourself as a Christian will not stand and be on the side of truth, but rather because you want to find a way to go and marry another woman, you go and gang up with your family against your wife, you are not a Christian. I mean, the Christian life should be distinct. I want to read something from the book Promised, Journey to the Promised Land. Mm-hmm. Actually, it's coming from the Patriarchs and Prophets. Okay. Listen, it says, the Israelites had already become very numerous. They were fruitful and increased abundantly and multiplied and were exceedingly mighty, and the land was filled with them. Under Joseph's fostering care and the favor of the king who was then ruling, they had spread rapidly over the land. But they had kept themselves a distinct race, having nothing in common with the Egyptians in customs or religion. And their increasing numbers now excited the fears of the king and his people. So even though they were in Egypt, they ensured that their custom, their religion was distinct. How distinct are we in this world? If we call ourselves God's people, if the world is moving along, can we say, oh, these people are different from the world, or we are in solution with them? How are we standing out? How are we standing out? We need to stand out. That will be the basis for which enemies would be angry with us. They will hate us and will want to pounce on us. Mm. That's the only time that deliverance will come.
Elder, as you say that we need to stand out, we need to be unique. Here, I understand that here are a people who are peculiar.
Yes.
And they find themselves in an area called Egypt.
Right.
And in this study so far, based on you and Nana's explanations, is it fair for me and my viewers to understand Egypt to be a representation of a place or concept of oppression, of suffering, of wickedness, of everything that stands in direct opposite to the identity of this peculiar people?
That's exactly what it is. Yes, that is the truth. You know, as Christians, let's not forget that this world, as we live in now, mm-hmm. does not belong to us. Even though in God's plan, this earth was made for man. Mm-hmm. But Satan has taken it. Mm-hmm. As we speak, he owns this earth. Mm-hmm. That is why he could tell Jesus Christ, I will give it to you mm-hmm. if you will bow to me. Mm-hmm. You understand? Mm-hmm. Therefore, if you will conform to the things of this world, then you are not for Christ. You need to be distinct. You wear a robe of righteousness, white robe. In this dark world, you should stand out. You should be a light that illuminates, for people to see the light and come. But if you yourself are wearing a black garment in a dark world, then how do we figure you out? We can't. So the fact is that Israel obeyed and they prospered. That their prosperity ignited the envy and the hatred of the people, of the Egyptians. But of course, God has said that they will spend 430 years there. Mm-hmm. Well, 430 if you're including the time span of Joseph mm-hmm. in Egypt, mm-hmm. but 400 years if you are not considering that. Joseph. Mm-hmm. So if God had prophesied, yet when they were there, they also ensured that they live a life distinct of the people. And so when they were being maltreated, the Bible says God heard their cry in Exodus, in Exodus chapter 3, verse 7.
Exodus chapter 3, verse 7.
Yes.
And the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people, which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry.
Exactly.
By reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows.
Now, are we crying?
That's the question I was going to ask you, Nana. So
Christians,
maybe you can
are we
start
crying?
Already.
Is there anything bothering us? Because when people are adding the zeros, we are doing the same. We are building houses that we cannot show our source of income. We can't. But we are building it. We are buying huge, huge things. Where did you get the money from? Let us look at the work you're doing. And let us look at your income. Does it match up to the assets you are acquiring on this earth?
Maybe it has been willed to me.
Well, that's fine. You'll show it to us. And Charles, let's not even joke around this because you see, we may say that, but God knows. You can't hide this from God. He knows it, that you did not acquire this, you know, faithfully. It was through some dubious means. But if this is the way we are going to live our world, then we are just like the Egyptians. And if Israel dissolved into Egypt and they were practicing their craft and their religion and their culture, and they were worshiping idols and enjoying themselves, and there was no difference between them and the Egyptians, why would they call on God for deliverance?
Nana, why would the Israelites call on God for deliverance? I mean, we have read from this text that the Israelites cried. We want to bring the lesson home to our days as we are living in these current times. How should our cry be represented? What should we do in our days to show that we are also crying like the Israelites were crying?
See, I mean, if I could borrow from where Elder left off, the whole idea about Christ's call to us is that he has called us to be a distinct people. Peter puts it in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. He says
you are a royal priesthood, a chosen nation. 1 Peter 2, 9. Let me read this for. And viewers, remember to always write these Bible verses down so that you are also able to follow us and ask your questions arising. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. And it reads, "But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, an holy nation, a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light."
Absolutely. So the Bible tells us that we are a peculiar people. Christians are supposed to model the life of Christ. You have been called from darkness. How do you meddle in the things that where you once were that God has called you from? You cannot continue in that state anymore. That is why if you are not distinct, I mean, I think the same Peter, he talks about suffering for God's glory. If we go to chapter 4 of 1 Peter.
All right. Yeah.
12.
Verse 12.
Verse 12.
Yes.
It reads, "Beloved, think ye not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened unto you. But rejoice, inasmuch as ye are partakers of Christ's suffering, that when his glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy."
Absolutely. Amen. You know, if you look at what Paul was saying to the Corinthian church, that this is not where God has called you to. If your only hope is about this life, then you are of all men most to be pitied. The Christian must understand that where he has been called to, like Elder said, this world is not, and all the apostles kept on saying that, this is not our destination. Home. This is not our home. We are looking forward to a city that is not built by human hands. And so a lot of Christians, unfortunately, are settled, you know, they are making this world their home where that's not God's plan for us. And that is why we are clamoring with the rest of the world, you know, gaining attention, the fame and all of that, as though this is where God has called us to. So I think this is a very, very big lesson for us to understand that the call is to be different. The call is out of darkness into light. And so however, wherever you find yourself, whether at work, at school, it is not only on Sabbath or on a Sunday when you go to church that you want to be different. God expects you to live a different life. And that different life is what will cause the world to be able to notice that this person is different. If he does not fall in line with us, what must we do? That is where affliction comes in. Mm. And that is when you would call on God. You call on God out of a sincere heart because you know you have followed his principles. Mm. And then he hears you and delivers you.
Yes.
But how do you call on him when you are not following him?
And nothing is happening to
you. And nothing is happening to you.
As a result of the obedience.
You see, to say that we are covenant people, mm-hmm. God does not have a relationship with any human except through a covenant.
Yes.
The covenant comes with promises, like Elder was saying. Mm-hmm. If you follow me, if you do this, these are the blessings that come mm-hmm. with it. Mm-hmm. If you do not follow my covenant laws and all that, these are the things that will happen to you. Where you are supposed to be a blessing when you go out and come in, you are supposed to be the head and not the tail and all of that. If you disobey God's covenant laws, the curses will come.
So then peculiarity, Elder, back to you.
Yes.
A peculiar people. Mm. A chosen generation,
right.
A royal priesthood.
Yes.
So Israelites in Egypt were also chosen.
Yes. Israel was a chosen nation. Israel never existed. Let us be clear about these things. Mm-hmm. Israel as a nation never existed. There were other nations, the Perizzites, the Jebusites, the Canaanites. Mm-hmm. These were nations that were existing.
Okay.
Israel never existed. Israel came out of Abraham.
Okay.
When he was called out of Mesopotamia.
And this, we studied it in our first
exactly.
episode.
Mm-hmm. So these people are peculiar. We call them a remnant. A remnant. The remnant concept is a biblical concept that begins even from Abel. Okay? It begins from Abel because they have peculiarities. They made sacrifices based on their belief in the Messiah. Even at the time when the Messiah had not come, their deliverance, their salvation was not based on works, mm. but on faith in the Messiah to come. And so Abel will make a sacrifice unto the Lord, admitting his sins, that I'm a sinner, and the only way my sins are remitted is through the sacrifice of an animal, mm-hmm. which represented Jesus the Messiah. Christ. So that is one of it, that righteousness, okay, is by faith. That is one of the attributes of the remnants. Mm-hmm. Remnancy, that is not about works, as people say that in the Old Testament, people were saved by their obedience to the law. This is a fallacy.
It's not in the Bible.
It is not in the Bible.
Because you have established for us that Abel, unlike Cain, went by the offering and sacrifice God had commanded.
Exactly.
And that made him different from Cain.
Exactly.
So right there, we see the concept of a peculiar people, a peculiar person, a chosen people.
Exactly.
So how does this peculiarity or remnancy trace from Abel
all
the way to these people in Egypt?
Very good.
Calling us remnants?
So if you take Abel, mm-hmm. he believed in righteousness by faith mm-hmm. through the blood.
Okay.
Okay. So that is one of the characteristics. Mm-hmm. When we look at somebody like Noah, mm-hmm. Noah. At the time that God told him that there was going to be rains, mm-hmm. it had never rained.
Mm.
You understand?
Mm-hmm.
How was he saved? Was he saved by works? He was saved because he believed. Even though he believed. And by grace, he was chosen. Grace is one of the other characteristics of the remnant. That they believe that their salvation is based on grace, not on works.
Lest any man should boast.
Exactly. You understand? Mm-hmm. Abraham, same thing. Abraham was accounted righteous, not because of works, but because he believed. When God said, look at the stars, Can you number them? He says, no, I cannot. He said, that is how your descendants are going to be. Meanwhile, I'm 99 years. I don't have, my wife is 89. How can we have a baby? But he believed, the Bible says, he believed and it was accounted unto him as righteousness. So those who have these qualities, these characteristics, and as a nation, when God chose Israel, all these characteristics are found in the nation Israel. So God gave them his oracles, his ordinances, and his laws, and his covenant.
To make them a peculiar
people. A peculiar people. Peculiar in the sense that Israel could not just eat anything they wanted. Israel could not drink just anything they wanted.
In fact, last week you even mentioned that their vocation, their profession, was also different from the
from the Egyptians when they went there. They were shepherds. Mm. You understand? Mm-hmm. Israel couldn't just go and marry any woman. No. It is God who prescribed all these things for them as a peculiar people.
It was not their origination.
No.
When you read, dictate this for themselves.
No. Let's read Exodus quickly before Exodus chapter 19, verse 5.
Exodus 19, verse 5.
Yes, let's read that.
This is what the Bible says.
Yes.
Now therefore, if ye will obey my voice indeed, and keep my covenants, mm-hmm. then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people,
now,
for all the earth is mine.
That is Amen. The point that Amen. We need to know, that every covenant that God had with his people was also conditioned. Look, when these days you hear people, your year of
deliverance,
year of
exaltation,
something, things like that.
Year of fruitfulness.
It's all about thinking about the good things. Mm. But they are all conditioned. Mm. Even if it is not mentioned, mm-hmm. if you're a Christian, you should know that God is a covenant God. Mm-hmm. When he talks about blessings he would bestow upon you, know that it is premised on a condition. Mm. You cannot live your life anyhow, behave anyhow, and then God will be blessing you. It's not possible.
I want to chip in, mm-hmm. you know, with the whole idea of the remnant and where it started from, you know, mm-hmm. because Elder picked it up from the Abel. Difference between mm-hmm. Cain and Abel mm-hmm. and all of that. You know, I think if we look at Genesis chapter 5, there is something that is interesting when we look at
Genesis chapter 5.
If we can read verses 1 to 3.
Verse 1 to 3. This is the book of the generations of Adam. In the day that God created man, in the likeness of God made he him. Male and female created he them, and blessed them, and called their name Adam, in the day when they were created. And Adam lived 130 years, and begat a son in his own likeness, after his image, and called his name Seth.
This is interesting. If you look at in verse 1, it clearly says that when God made Adam and Eve, he made them in his own image.
Okay.
Now, after Adam had lived 130 years, mm-hmm. we know that at that point, sin had been introduced into the world.
Right.
And so he said he begot a son, this time, not in the image of God, but in the image of
Adam.
He, Adam, who had become what? A sinful being. Mm. He was fallen then. Mm. So it's interesting if you see the difference between the first line of people that God created mm-hmm. and then everybody who was created after sin had entered the world. Mm-hmm. We started to take on the character, the image of Adam who had sinned. This is where the whole concept of being born again comes in. Now, back to the genealogy. Mm-hmm. Now, we see Cain mm-hmm. and Abel. Cain has killed Abel. Mm-hmm. Cain believes in righteousness by works. You know, Abel believes in righteousness by faith. He is the one who has gone to give a sacrifice based on what
God
himself has asked for. But interesting again, if you look at Genesis chapter 4, verse 26.
Genesis 4, 26. And it reads, and to Seth, to him also there was born a son, and he called his name Enos. Then began men to call upon the name of the Lord.
What is it telling us? After Abel had died mm-hmm. and Cain had gone with his line, mm-hmm. who were they calling on then? Who were they worshipping?
It means they have departed
from. They had departed from God. And so when Seth was born and he gave birth to his son Enoch, the Bible clearly tells us at that point, men began to call on the name of the Lord. So it's interesting.
So between a peculiar people.
A peculiar people are being drawn from that line again. And that is why when you get to chapter 6, when God is, you know, hurt or, you know, regrets that he has made man and all of that, he finds Noah.
So my question then is, at every point in the earth's history, God has a peculiar people he has called.
Absolutely.
That's the concept of remnant.
Again, we can look at Romans chapter 10. It brings it out.
Okay. Romans chapter 10.
Right. Romans 11 verse 5, please.
Romans 11 verse 5. And the Bible, it reads, even so then at this present time also, there is a remnant according to the election of grace.
Amen. Amen.
So absolutely, the question that you ask, right from the beginning of time, even when men departed from God, God always had a remnant. So the concept of remnant is not new. It has been traced right from there, you know, through the promises of Abraham, through Jacob and Isaac, you know, the calling out of Israel. When we read Exodus 19 verse 5 and all of that, Israel was not chosen because they were numerous. It was actually based on promise. Yes. These were the remnants.
So in this time when we live, God is also having a remnant.
God does have a remnant. Why? Because what is the concept? Remnant means the remains after a catastrophe. Mm-hmm. Like, let's say a place has been burnt. Mm-hmm. Recently, Maui in Hawaii has been burnt. Mm-hmm. But there are some remains. When you go, you can identify the people from the remains. So when we're talking about a remnant, we are saying that if Israel was a remnant of God, chosen people, all right, in this day, can we also find a group of people who have the same characteristics as the chosen Israel? Mm-hmm. What were the, we have started mentioning some of the characteristics.
Yes.
Did they obey, were they given the commandments of God? Did they obey the commandments?
Mm-hmm.
Do you understand? Mm-hmm. What were the commandments? Mm-hmm. There were 10 commandments, including the Sabbath commandment. Mm-hmm. Are people obeying God's commandment these days? Or are we saying we are under grace, therefore the commandments are of no value? Are people, what about our diet? Are we careful about clean and unclean things? Mm-hmm. Or we are saying that Jesus Christ has died, so his blood has sanctified every everything. Meat? I mean, when I, listen Charles, this is very hurting, eh?
Mm.
It's so hurting to think that people will think that Jesus will come from heaven to come and die just so that you can eat pork. I mean, can you imagine? How can we make Christ like this?
Reduce
Christ to this level. That Christ came to die so that you could eat pork. And that his blood has sanctified pork for you to eat.
When he has expressly mentioned that these are unclean animals.
In 1 Corinthians 10:31, he says, whatever you drink or whatever you eat, do it to what?
The glory
now,
of
do
God.
You understand? He said glory.
Glory.
Which means the character. Which means that if God is eating, right? Mm-hmm. If God is eating, eat what God will eat.
Mm.
So if God tells you that, don't, he told children of Israel, don't eat unclean meat, including pork, snails, crustaceans, and all these things. Then he comes into the New Testament and says, now eat pork.
Because
I, God, I'm eating pork. I mean, please, is God, does God remain God if he's like that? A fickle-minded person.
Nana, you want to add something to this?
I want to add something, and I can sense, you know, elders' frustration.
Mm-hmm.
But this also is just because of sometimes the misinterpretation of scripture.
Mm.
Because there are scriptures that, you know, perhaps people think what it is alluding to. You know, if you look at, I think, Acts chapter 10,
mm-hmm.
Where Paul Peter says that I have never eaten anything unclean. And then the voice tells him, you know, what I have cleansed, you should not, you know, say, you should not call unclean. But the scripture, when you read on, tells us that it was not referring to animals. It was referring to the Gentiles. And so when sometimes we pick scriptures out of context, that is this, conclusion we come to. We come to wrong conclusions on that. But on the issue of the remnant and today, I mean, you are asking whether today currently. The Bible also clearly tells us, I mean, even in the last days, in the book of Revelation, we see clearly that even the devil knows, he has no confusion when it comes to who the remnant of God are. And I like the fact that Elder has taken time to explain the remnant. The remnant are the remains of a people. And so, what is it that you find among these people that you can trace back to the original people who were called? This is what is important. And the devil knows that. He identifies the people of God based on these characteristics. So, Revelation chapter 12, verse 17.
Revelation 12, 17. And it reads, "And the dragon was wroth with the woman, and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God, and have the testimony of Jesus Christ."
Absolutely. Amen. So the devil himself
knows.
It is not something that he is fickle about. He clearly says that, "I am after these group of people. They are the ones that I want to bring persecution, affliction, and all that to." And what are the characteristics? At least here he mentions two key characteristics.
Summarizing them here. That which keep the commandments of God.
Absolutely.
Have the testimony of Jesus Christ.
Absolutely. Right.
So this is the defining attributes of the remnants. Exactly. And we can say that in the case of the Israelites too, their remnancy were hinged on this.
Oh, yes.
They kept the commandments of God and had the testimony of Jesus
Christ. In Ezekiel chapter 20. Ezekiel chapter 20.
Ezekiel chapter 20.
Yes. Ezekiel 20 verse 12.
Ezekiel 20 verse 12.
Yeah.
As we are reading for our viewers, it says that, "Moreover also I gave them my Sabbaths to be a sign between me and them, that they might know that I am the Lord that sanctify them."
That sanctifies them. That means that our sanctification, God's changing our lives and transforming us, okay, into his likeness. We need that identity to be linked to him through the Sabbath. You understand? The Sabbath observance is not just about a day, as we have clearly indicated. It is the authority of God that makes him the creator. And if you accept him as your creator, then you have to observe and keep that day holy, as he has commanded. In Exodus chapter 31, verse 17.
Exodus 31:17. "It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord had made heaven and earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed."
Exactly. You understand? The Sabbath is a sign. It's like today we have the cross as a sign for Christians. The Sabbath is a sign. Even now, if you go to UK in Golders Green on Sabbath, you see the Jews. They wear their peculiar hat, draped in black, suit, and they are going to church. No one has to tell you that these are
it is the
Jews.
Sabbath.
It is a sign. You understand? If God is looking for his people, right, he sees those who worship on the Sabbath, and he knows that these are my people. That's what he's saying. It is a sign between me and my people.
But some will say that, I mean, this Sabbath, there were several Sabbaths, and so it was nailed to the cross, and it is not binding.
Oh, well, interesting. The Sabbath that God is talking about here, mm-hmm. there were several Sabbaths, mm-hmm. because the word Sabbath means rest. Mm-hmm. But what God is talking about here is a seventh day Sabbath, not a holy day.
It's the holy day.
It is the holy day. The seventh day Sabbath is a holy day. It's a holy day. And it's a day for holy convocation, assembly. When you read Leviticus chapter 23.
Leviticus chapter 23.
Leviticus 23 verse, just a second. Leviticus 23. Verse 3. Yes.
6 days shall work be done, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of rest and holy convocation. You shall do no work therein. It is the Sabbath of the Lord in all your dwellings.
You see?
All our dwellings.
It is for a holy convocation.
Meeting.
Some say that, oh, I can keep the Sabbath in my room. God didn't say that keep the Sabbath in your room.
Maybe if I invite you and Nana Fori Brown and we are together, would that not be a
no,
holy...
No, that's not what God means. It's a holy assembly of God's people for worship. You understand? God expects us to worship Him if we acknowledge Him as our Creator. Mm-hmm. Even earthly monarchs, mm-hmm. they
are expecting worship.
Yes. Yes. We have all kinds of festivals that people on that particular day, all citizens go and pay homage, mm-hmm. and respect, mm-hmm. to their king. Mm-hmm. How much the king of the universe? How much?
So at least we have understood that the children of Israel, as they were still in bondage, yes. in Egypt,
yes.
the qualifying characteristic of them as a remnant,
yes.
as a people chosen, is linked to the Revelation 12:17 text we read.
Exactly. Yes. And whilst they were Jews, mm-hmm. in the New Testament, mm-hmm. God's people, mm-hmm. are also obligated to keep it
because
as a sign, mm-hmm. between them and God.
So it's not for the Jews.
Not at all.
It's not for the Israelites.
No, because the remnant, mm-hmm. the devil went to war against the seed, mm-hmm. of the woman, the rest of her offspring, mm-hmm. the remnant. Mm-hmm. And these people, they keep the commandment of God and the testimony
of Jesus Christ.
And Revelation chapter 19, verse 10, tells us what the testimony of Jesus Christ is.
Revelation chapter 19, verse 10.
Yes.
And it reads, "And I fell at his feet to worship him. And he said unto me, See thou do it not. I am thy fellow servant and of thy brethren that have the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy."
That's it.
Nana, I want to add something to it.
Yes, I mean, I think you asked a question on, you know, people would say that the Sabbath is for the Jews.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's important that we trace it back to the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
In Genesis chapter 2,
mm-hmm.
We need to ask ourselves a question of, how many tribes were there on this earth?
Mm. Good question.
Yes. So when God established the Sabbath, how many tribes were there?
Okay.
If we can say that there were Jews and Gentiles then,
mm-hmm.
then we can probably be able to agree with those who say that God had set it up for the Jews only. But in this text, in Genesis chapter 2, the Bible says that it was after creation,
mm-hmm.
that God set the day apart, rested on it, and then hallowed it and gave it to man. That is why, again, if you read Mark chapter 12,
mm-hmm.
Is it Matthew chapter 12, rather?
Mm-hmm.
I think it's Matthew chapter 12, where he says that the Sabbath was made for man.
Okay.
And that word shows that mankind,
mm-hmm.
it was not a specific group of people.
That's right.
That God made it for.
Mm-hmm.
It was for man.
It was for man.
And so if you identify yourself as God's creation, then God made the Sabbath for you.
Mm-hmm. So in essence, the children of Israel are in bondage. They have cried unto God. Yeah. They are a remnant people, and they have cried unto God. God has seen their affliction. How were they to be delivered, Elder?
You know, before Israel went to Egypt, they didn't go there as slaves. Rather, they were enslaved whilst they were there.
They went as a free people.
They went as a free people through their grandfather, Jacob, Israel, as they settled in Goshen. But before they went there, there was a prophecy that had been given by God in Genesis 15. Genesis chapter 15. Read from verse 13.
And he said unto Abram, know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. And also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge, and afterward shall they come out with great substance.
Exactly. So God had already said this to Abraham. God, with his omniscient knowledge, as we had read from Isaiah 46, verse 10, God knows the beginning from the end and the end from the beginning. Nothing is oblivious to God. God knows everything. But he does not necessarily cause it to happen. Mm. But he knows that it will happen. Now, Israel had been in Egypt for 400 years, and they have been enslaved, unfortunately. But you see, their enslavement led them to cry unto the Lord because they were being maltreated. They didn't do anything wrong. The only thing wrong they had done was to obey God, worship their God, and receive blessings from God, multiply and expand on in the territory of Egypt. And then they had become a fear to the Egyptians. And for that reason, they had to subjugate them and maltreat them so that they will fear the Egyptians. But one thing that is clear was that Israel had kept themselves a distinct group. And this I want to emphasize, that as children of God, living in this world, if we are called the remnant, we need to be a distinct group in our culture, in our religion. Because Christians don't have a culture of their own, which is linked to their biological origins. That is not it. As a Ghana, as an Ashanti, or whatever. Christians have one tradition.
And what is that?
That their tradition is stemmed from the Bible. It's the Jewish tradition. Because the Jews were selected by God. It wasn't an existing nation as the Canaanites and the Amorites and the Ammonites and all these people were there. They were heathens. But Israel was chosen by God, and God dictated to them how they had to live, which women they had to marry, what they had to eat, what friends they had to make. Every aspect of their lives was dictated by God. So if Christians want to follow God, then God is saying, come out of your country, come out of your family, out of your household, come out from your culture and your traditions and become mine. I will tell you what to do. I will give you your tradition.
And that's the peculiarity of the people.
Yes!
Nana, you want to say something?
Absolutely. I mean, I think, you know, just to add to what Elder was saying, if you look at even Jesus Christ, the Bible, and we have already traced where he came from, that he came he was a seed that was promised right from Genesis chapter 3 and all of that. But if you look at Luke chapter 4, the verse 16.
Luke chapter 4, verse 16.
It tells us what custom that Jesus Christ himself kept.
Luke chapter 4.
Verse 16.
Verse 16. Okay, this is what the Bible says. And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read.
Yes. Mm. So if Jesus kept that custom, and we say we are followers of Jesus, should our custom be different from what our master?
So as a remnant, our custom is this custom too.
Absolutely. It is very, very
clear. In our days, for all of us living in this time, our custom should be this custom of Jesus.
I think when we get to Heaven's Gate, imagine that we go and say to God, let's assume that Sabbath keepers are wrong, as you know, majority of the Christian followers would say. But assuming we get to that gate and, you know, we make the argument, well, God, we kept it because our Lord and Savior, that you said you were calling us to be like, we followed his custom. As against others who would say, well, we decided that he
was, we could choose any day,
we could choose any day to honor you. Just like Cain and Abel. Cain came and he said, look, you know, I want to choose what, you know, I'm a farmer. This is what is convenient for me.
So I'll bring this.
I'll bring what is convenient for me. Forget about all your rules and your dictates and what your custom is and all of that. I don't care about it, but this is convenient for me. As today we would say, for a lot of people, I think Sundays are convenient for them. And so that's what they want to keep. You know. So we, if we are going to be true to this calling for each and every one of us who have been called, I think we need to go back to, what does our master,
whom we are following,
whom we are following,
what his custom was.
Exactly.
And so the Israelites, as a remnant, God delivered them. And by what means? You have told us the prophecy. And how did this play out, since you told us that God necessarily doesn't dictate how these things should play out?
You know, I told you that in Exodus chapter three. That the children of Israel, they cried. Let's go to chapter 3, verse 7 and 8.
And the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people, which are in Egypt, and I've heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them out, up out of that land, unto a good land, and a large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites. Therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me, and I've also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptian oppresses them.
Exactly. So out of their situation, the oppression they were going through, they cried out. They cried out, but one thing has led to one another. They were oppressed because they were being blessed, okay? And they were being distinct. They never allowed themselves to be influenced by the tradition and culture of the Egyptians.
Although they were living with them.
Even though they were living there, they were not like them. No, they were not.
They were distinct.
They were distinct people. They were distinct people. The Bible makes it clear. Even in childbirth, their women delivered faster. The Jewish women delivered faster than the Egyptians. That alone, especially with women, you can imagine. That was an envy and a jealousy on their part. Why is it that when we go to deliver,
they deliver like a hen is laying an egg?
You know? But that is how God blesses his people, when they are obedient to him and they follow his precepts.
And it was through such delivery that a boy child Moses was born.
That's how the boy Moses was born. And when he was born by Amram and Jochebed, he was such a nice baby. They could not afford to go and throw this nice baby into the river now to die, because according to Pharaoh, all male children, firstborn, were to die. You know, but this was instigated by the devil, because Satan knew that Israel was a channel through which the Messiah
Jesus
was going
come.
To come one day. Mm. Therefore, he wanted to truncate it. Right here, Israel was to cease to exist. If he had succeeded, then we will still continue.
But then here, God preserved Moses' life.
Exactly.
So, Nana, even as we wrap up, we have just 2 minutes to go. What do we say to our viewers out there watching us, looking at the circumstances with the birth of Moses, that everything was marshalled by the devil and his, tools and agents to make sure that this boy possibly could have been killed and wouldn't have survived. But then this boy gets taken into custody by, you know, Pharaoh's daughter, and then Miriam is just nearby, and she says, I know someone who can take care of this and all of this. What does this tell for the child of God watching us, who is going through affliction and difficulty and troubles, that with such circumstances, God is able to deliver his people, work out his purposes? What does this tell us as believers?
I think the first thing that comes to mind is what Paul says in Romans chapter 8, that nothing can ever separate us from God's love.
Okay.
I mean, when we look at that story, could we think that it is a coincidence for that Pharaoh's daughter was bathing in the Nile at the very time when, you know, the basket wherein Moses lay was put on the Nile? All of these things were orchestrated by God so that Moses will end up in Pharaoh's house. And so we look back and, you know, when the Bible tells us as children of God that we have a heritage. And I'd like for us to read Isaiah 54 verse 17.
And this is our last text for today, Isaiah 54 verse 17. Isaiah 54 verse 17. And this is what the Bible says. No weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper. And every tongue that shall rise against thee in judgment, thou shalt condemn.
Amen.
This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is of me, saith the Lord. Amen.
Charles, please help us to understand, and our viewers to understand, what is the word heritage? What does it mean?
This is something that is bequeathed. This is our inheritance. It is given us.
Absolutely. And so if we are servants of God, that is why Paul will tell us that, you know, let no anxiety seize you. Do not worry about anything. If it's God's plan and purpose for you, everything that is even orchestrated for you, even when it is meant for evil, God will turn it out for good.
Child of God watching us, today we have heard that notwithstanding our standing right for God and being a peculiar people, a chosen nation, a royal priesthood, as we go through all of this and are peculiar, it attracts the envy and hatred of Satan and his powers. But be rest assured, look at the beautiful circumstances under which Moses' life was preserved. It tells us that God, nothing gets lost in the sight of God. And so he's able to make a way for us. And as Jesus Christ, the promised child, was born and he came to die and save us, so do we have a blessed hope and assurance that indeed he who has promised is faithful. Today, we are joined by Nana Fori Brown, who is the personal ministries leader at the Prince Emmanuel Seventh-day Adventist Church, and Elder Ernest Kusi Abebio, who worships with the Legon Seventh-day Adventist Church. And you at home, the viewer, where we looked at a chosen leader, because the deliverance of God's children out of Egypt has been set in motion. Thank you for joining us. I've been your host, Charles Othonelabe. See you same time, God willing, next week, where we come your way again with the program From Egypt to Canaan, Our Christian Journey. Bye-bye.